Now, our first guest this morning boasts of an impressive portfolio of over 300 projects and more than 10,000 hectares of land in 70 cities and municipalities across 15 provinces, ranging from townships to condo hotels to golf courses to offices, commercial spaces and housing units. The company actually, according to some data, posted a 26.5% growth in revenues in 2022 to $9.9 billion versus 2019. Pre-COVID levels. That's a CAGR of about 8.2%. And in its latest available earnings report, posted a 10% growth in net income at 3.2 billion pesos. Joining us this morning for our company call is the CFO of XE Robles de Santa Lucia Land, David de la Cruz. David, good morning. Thank you so much for joining us.
Thanks for having me.
All right. So give us a sense of where we are in real estate. Has it bottomed already?
Well, anytime we have a GDP of 5.6%, and if the forecast it is going northwards, and if you have a backlog in housing of about 6 to 8 million, then the future is always bright with the real estate industry. Now, there seems to be a shift now in developments from the central business districts to the fringes of Metro Manila, mainly because the work from home theory is no longer a theory, but it's a practice right now. So people heavily invested in internet at home. The work from home is now like two days per week. So people who live outside Metro Manila choose to just acquire properties where they are, as opposed to buying condominiums in the CBDs. Mm-hmm. But in terms of housing demand, we still have a lot to work on. It's not just us, but the entire real estate industry. Again, if the backlog is about 6 to 8 million, there's really a lot of work for us to do, and population growth of about less than 2%.
Mm-hmm. But David, many people know Santa Lucia Land for its massive land bank, not exactly for developing actual developments like townships or residential houses.
Right.
But I understand you are now starting to shift your focus. You want to be, instead of just a realtor, you want to become a developer. Why the change?
Well,
because I remember, yeah. David, a few years ago, the owner, Mr. Robles, said, you know, the margins for developing houses, unattractive. That's why he focused on just selling lots.
Right. Okay. We will still continue to develop lots only. And a bit of a backtrack. Prior to 2015, when we first raised debt in the debt capital markets, the company was employing the joint venture model, whereby they will rely on landowners and will strike a deal, let's say 50-50, they contribute the land and we develop the property for them. But since 2015, when we started raising money from the debt markets and to some extent from the equity market, we started buying our own land. And to the development of the subdivision right now is just on lots. I think the next phase is to build houses and to put commercial properties to evolve into a fully integrated subdivision community. So we've done the first step, which is building the lots. In the next 10 years, our strategy is to try to put houses on those lots, which would actually increase the value of those lots, and to put in the commercial component. Right now, we have about 120 hectares of commercial assets just sitting in our balance sheet, and we've been talking to major retailers to put up a commercial establishment. We still don't have the balance sheet to finance all of those projects, but maybe in the next 10 years we'll seriously look at increasing our commercial portfolio.
Mm-hmm. Just very quickly, to set the record straight, how big is your land bank today?
It's a moving target. It's anywhere between 2,500 to 2,800. And I say it's a moving target because when we acquire land or when we close a JV agreement, in a week we start selling these properties, mm-hmm. and maybe after a week my shareholders are buying new properties. So it's a moving average. I would say of about 2,600 hectares.
And you are still employing the JV model?
We are still employing the JV model, but maybe to a lower extent.
Mm-hmm.
The JV model is an asset light model. It allows us to stretch our balance sheet to the limit, but obviously the other side of the coin is that you're dealing with, you know, different personalities, different agreements. Every time you need to do something, you have to ask your JV partner. Owning your own land allows you the flexibility to do whatever you want.
And out of the 2,600 average moving target for land bank, how much is owned by the company? How much is owned by JV partners?
That's already ours.
Just company owned.
I would say about one half of that is company owned, and one half of the JV is ours. So we have 1/3, and then we have 1/3 of 2/6, which is the joint venture part.
All right. And when you look for JV partners, are you looking at the big players? Because we remember a few years ago, there was supposed to be a deal with the SM Group to co-develop malls.
Well, the SM Group's deal was more on the commercial side. Mm-hmm. So that deal was for them to infuse some equity, and then they will have right of first refusal to all our commercial assets. But yeah, on the questions on the JV, on the properties, it's really, the company is like 50 years. I'm talking about the entire group. Mm-hmm. It's 50 years in existence, and all the JVs really came from, I would say, the natural course of time, word of mouth. We've been dealing with a lot of big families on the JV, but we're also dealing with a lot of people in the provinces consolidating big tracts of land for them.
Mm-hmm. You did say 50 years. This company has a very rich history of over 50 years.
Yes.
And the land banking that you did focuses mostly on the fringes, correct?
Yes.
But one of the more famous projects you're known for is the Acropolis.
Yes.
Where you did see, I understand currently it's 300,000 per square versus just 800 pesos per square, what, 30? But that was 30, 40 years ago.
Yes.
So what is your outlook for the price jumps when you land bank these lots, sell them out, and then develop around these lots to be able to benefit from future value?
Well, you know, some of the classic example, thank you for that, Acropolis Libis. That wasn't really meant to be a Class A subdivision, but, you know, Green Meadows sprouted. Eastwood suddenly was developed right in front of the subdivision, and therefore now it's a Class A subdivision. Our shareholders, or my owners, when they look at projects, they really look at the propensity for asset appreciation. Our strength is never really in the CBDs. Our strengths really are the fringes of Metro Manila. Like, for instance, we have a project in Iloilo. It was selling for, let's say, 5,000, and then suddenly there was a road that was erected by the national government. It's not even a BBB initiative project, and then it just doubled, tripled in price. Uh-huh. I would say that the projects that we enter into are probably low in value today, but because of infrastructure development, it's going to just find its correct value. To cite you an example, we have a project in Baras that's in the far east, I mean, far eastern of Metro Manila, mm-hmm. near the Tanay area. It's just about 40 kilometers away from Makati, but it's selling for 7,000, 8,000. Makati average is about 150,000. I'm talking about the average Makati, mm-hmm. not just the CBDs, but the residential. So if you look at the price difference, it's like almost 20 times difference. If you look at the CBDs, it's about 500,000. So the arbitrage in prices of a 42-kilometer difference between two locations is 30 times, 20 times, only because there's no infrastructure. Like, let's for instance, in the US, there's like 22 kilometers per 1,000 persons. In Japan, there's 9 kilometers per 1,000 persons. In the Philippines, we have like 3 kilometers per 1,000 person. But you argue Japan has 9, but they have like 184 meters of railways per person versus 11. For the Philippines. So if you look at the upside, if we do have railways, more railways and more roads, then property values, the arbitrage would probably be minimized, if not disappear.
Mm-hmm. All right. And where do you see the next leg of growth coming from? I imagine this is not all luck, that your team just happens to pinpoint, you know, close their eyes and point, okay, I'm going to buy next here and here. There is a science to this. So where is the next?
Well, funny enough, my bosses, Mr. Ezequiel Robles and Vicente Santos, they have a knack for just identifying properties. I myself do not understand if there's a science to it or it's just a natural gift. But the targets that we have are more of expansions on where we are. We are heavy in Cavite, Laguna, Batangas, Rizal, Quezon, Bataan,
Calabarzon,
Bataan, Benguet, Bacolod. Davao, Iloilo, Cebu, Pampanga, Pangasinan, Palawan.
You're everywhere.
Pretty much everywhere in South Cotabato, in Zambales. So they see something, a potential for growth in those areas. And we, to some extent, take a huge risk by investing in these assets. But you know, it's proven that assets appreciate, because in our books, all our inventory appreciates by about 17% on the average every year, as opposed to the national average of about 8 to 9%. On the areas we focus on, in addition to those where we are already present, we look at the regional GDPs. Like in 2019, the regional GDP actually of Davao and Calabarzon is higher than the regional GDP of NCR. Mm-hmm. So these are the metrics that we look at.
Wow, you are crunching a lot of numbers,
yes.
Not just on the sales and sales and buying side. David, I wonder, you know, you can't talk about property without talking about banks and interest rates.
Yes.
And we hear a lot of stories about banks and sponsors and deal makers, you know, dealing loans that were made in a different environment, in a different moment in time when rates were low. But rates are high today.
Yes.
Higher for longer. The expectation is it's going to start to come down.
Yes.
How is that affecting the way you strategize your business?
Okay.
Did you take a big hit?
Well, our average cost of funds probably increased by about 30 to 40% just over the past 24 months. So, I mean, during the pandemic, when interest rates were low, I think everybody, all the real estate companies were enjoying low cost
cheap
of financing,
money.
Cheap money, right? But now it's kind of difficult, especially like when you need to refinance those debt that you incurred like 3 to 4 years ago. So yes, we took a big hit. We're trying to manage our balance sheet and our expansion plans. So to be honest, our expansion plans has to be tamed a bit. Mm-hmm. But because real estate is an asset class by itself, that appreciates also by itself, we have the flexibility to have some increases in prices. Mm-hmm. So we can actually pass on some of the increases to the consumers, to the buyers. Yeah.
But do you, as Santa Lucia Land, feel that you have a comparative advantage to access to capital? You don't just tap the banks. You can raise money through equity, debt capital markets. Are you looking to raise funds?
I was just looking at the numbers. So unfortunately, the real estate industry, and I speak for all the players, like the developers, we're the most, I guess, misunderstood industry, because you know, prior to 2008, when the Asia miracle was the buzzword globally, and then 2008 happened, the Asian financial crisis, when all the Asian economies were deemed to be overvalued, and therefore the 50% depreciation of the peso, and therefore the rise in interest rates. That was 2008. That was 1998. Mm-hmm. Then we were trying
Asian
to recover 2004, 2005, and then 2008 happened.
The global financial crisis,
the credit default swaps in the U.S., which is really the financial instrument surrounding the real estate industry again, and therefore that's another hit for the real estate industry. And now, We after 2008, there was a bull market, but it wasn't really in the real estate industry. And now we have Evergrande in China. And you just reported a while
Country
ago. Garden Holdings has defaulted on their loan. So again, real estate has always been the culprit. We're short of being vilified as the industry that causes the financial crisis. So I speak for all and all on behalf of the real estate companies, especially the developers. It's kind of difficult to raise capital in the equities right now.
Mm-hmm. But do you have plans?
We do have plans.
This year? How much?
We always have plans. We're a listed firm. If we can sell 10-20% of our equity, that would be helpful in maybe reducing our leverage. Although our leverage is still very manageable at almost 1:1.
Huh. All right.
But it would be nice to have some equity capital, of course.
All right. We are going to be looking forward to that news. I want to end with your eye on the future. So you are not just focusing on selling lots anymore. You want to build around those lots. You mentioned commercial spaces, retail. What about warehousing, the industrial side of things? I mean, generative AI, we're going to need a lot of data centers.
I don't think, okay, my owners, they really stick to what they're good at, which is really building residential subdivisions. Now, we do have commercial lots available as a as an integral part of a residential development, there's always a commercial component. And I think a while ago, I said it's about 120 hectares. So maybe those can be available for warehouses, but we're not going to be operating it. We probably would lease it out. Mm-hmm. But we're not going to be a warehouse operator. I think we'll stick to
data centers, not as
I don't think we're going to operate it unless we find a partner or suitable partner, but that's not really in the radar right now.
All right. On that note, David, thank you so much for joining us and for sharing with us some of these exciting developments from Santa Lucia Land. We hope to hear more good news from the company. See you soon.
Thank you for having me.
All right.